I think I sit here and say just a couple of words on a couple of issues. First, do what others have done, but I think is highly appropriate, to congratulate ORF on an excellent conference. IFI, I think, is really world-class gathering on of talent and talkers and thinkers on some of the most important issues facing us. And they are really important. I think if there's one message that we from the Commission side want to give to not primarily you, but to the policymakers around the world that don't normally confront these particular issues, it is that you ain't seen nothing yet. We are in the beginning, in my opinion, not of the fourth industrial revolution, as some people are saying, but we are in the end phase of the industrial revolution and the beginning of the digital revolution that is truly going to transform our societies. Just a couple of small facts. Within 5 years from now, on present trends, 90% of the population of the world will be covered by mobile broadband networks with a capacity equal or better of what we have in most of Europe today. 90% of the population of the world will be covered. And at the same time, we know that the price and capability of smart devices is coming down, prices up and capacity up. So I would say that within the very foreseeable future, most of the young people of the world will be connected to the net. And that is when the 5G revolution starts. And the 5G will, in its initial phases, have a capacity factor 100 better than the networks that are the best today. Connectivity will be exploding around the world. Do we know the consequences of that? No, we don't. At the same time, new technologies. Blockchains, discussed quite a lot. We don't really know where it's heading. But some of the people on our commission and elsewhere are saying that blockchain is today roughly where the internet was late 80s, early 90s, before the web was even invented. So where will that be in 10 years' time? I saw yesterday that most of the giants of the US tech industry came together in a new, very big consortium on artificial intelligence. Where is that going to take us in 5 years' time? And we already see now the effects on the global economy. One of the big pieces of news the last few weeks, for those who follow global economy, has been that trade in goods, merchandise trade, is now for the first time below the growth, the global growth figures. It used to be prior to 2008, 2009, trade growth was double the global growth. Now it's below. And we see some of the container shipping lines, the Korean one notably, being in deep financial difficulties. So the global trade merchandise volumes are not growing as they did. At the same time, since 2008, digital flows have been increasing by a factor of 45 across the world. And estimates here that they will go a further 10 times in the coming 5 years. So we will have sort of digital value chains driving the global economy. And that will change patterns of production and patterns of localization in a more profound way than most of us are aware of. Back to the Commission. We were set up 2.5 years ago. Thinking started 3 years ago. And to be quite honest with you, it started with a much more narrow focus. It started with ICANN, IANA transition, internet governance narrowly defined. Because that was and remains a controversial issue. Although these very hours, I hope we are in the final phases of doing that important transition. The US government has been delivering. We hope that the final proceedings can complete. But in the course of our proceedings, and we spent 2 years, we had 10 meetings around the world, including here in India, which is very important. There were 29 offers. We are coming from very different corners of the world in geographic terms, but also in terms of professional experience, background, and outlook on these particular issues. And as Latha can tell you, probably it took us 2 or 3 meetings before we started to really meld together as a commission and develop a more or less unified approach on these issues. But apart from the commissioners, we have a research network of academics and researchers, probably the best that has been gathered in the world, that issued in the order of 50 different research reports that you can all find on the net. Some of them fairly detailed, some of them you will say we've read it before, but some of them groundbreaking. I would recommend, if you are interested in the surveillance issues, which loomed very large in our debates in the beginning, one of the reports, Sir David Oman from the UK has written, which is probably the best open thing that has been written on those issues anywhere in the world. And if you're interested in, which you should be, in the deep web and the dark web, and what happens there and what could happen there, a very good report by Toby Simon of Bangalore and Michael Chertoff of the US. But that's among the 50 different reports. Now, what do we deal with in the report? Well, virtually everything. Without really, and I would say we probably ended up having more questions than answers, but indicating routes ahead. Large numbers of recommendations to policymakers on the governance issues, certainly supporting the multi-stakeholder approach, but having perhaps a somewhat more nuanced approach to that. Because we're saying, yes, multi-stakeholder approach, very important for part of it, but there are other parts of it where states are important when it comes to the legal issues, the rule of law, which is both fighting criminality from terrorists to burglars, but also protecting freedom of speech and freedom of information online. So states have a role, and states have a role also in what they are not doing. What we've seen during the last few years is, of course, that virtually any conflict in the world has now a cyber dimension, and cyber wars is becoming a very real possibility. We've seen gone from what happened with Estonia some years ago to X numbers of things that have been happening in the last year with the Russians trying to take out the power grid of Ukraine as just one of the examples, and in the Middle East, a number of others. Security issues, of course, exploding. The Yahoo bridge the other day, I haven't seen the details of it, but that's just the latest of these. The beginning of a dialogue between governments on how to regulate these particular ones, both bilaterally, US-China most notably, but also within the UN framework. Also concern about how the big private corporations are dealing with privacy and information issues. And related to that, the trust issues that are becoming, and was very much the focus of our discussion, the risk that both people and others are losing trust in the net and in the way in which both states and private actors are using the net, from surveillance to big data to whatever the commercial opportunities are there, and the necessity to move towards what we call the new social contract of responsible behavior by everyone on the net. I could go on encryption issues, just to mention another one of the critical issues that we spend quite some time on, and which are, in my opinion, absolutely critical to the future. Because if we can't safeguard the integrity of the data, privacy is one thing, but the integrity of the data that are there, be that private data, or be that commercial data, or be that whatever else, then everything is going to come down crashing the one way or the other. So, finally, enormous potential in the development of the net, notably for countries like India, Africa, whatever, but also enormous challenges. The internet could break, it could fail, it could crash if these things are not handled appropriately by policy makers, individuals and private actors alike. So I would say our report is a call for action perhaps, but call for thinking, and a call for policymakers all over the world to wake up to the realities of something that is going to be very big. India has been looming large in our debates, both in terms of being the second biggest internet country in the world, and also in terms of the talent that India represents in the internet world, but also in terms of the contributions of India to our discussions.
Thank you.
So before we get into the panel discussion with Mr. Bilton, Ambassador Reddy, let me also invite onto the stage Yuri Rosenthal, who is the former Foreign Minister of the Netherlands and currently the Special Envoy on International Cyber Policy. Sir? Thank you, sir. We have roughly 35 minutes, so I'm going to make this, I'm going to rush you through the questions, all three panelists. What is the relevance of, how, or rather, if I could rephrase it, how have you been highlighting the relevance of the Commission's report in a non-Western capital like New Delhi? Because by my count, there were 29 commissioners in the involved in the process, 16 of them, and overwhelming majority were from Western Europe and North America, if I'm not mistaken. India was well represented. I don't know if that also holds true for the rest of the developing world. But how would you highlight the significance of a report to the developing economies?
It's to me. I don't know the numbers of the different, but Asia was fairly well represented. Africa was represented. Latin America did it. Yeah, it was a lot of Africa, a lot of Asia. Latin America had a representative that didn't turn up that much, to be quite honest, but that was it. In my opinion, this old division that we have between the developed and the developing world doesn't apply in the cyberspace. We are all developing countries, and we have to understand that we are all developing countries. And what we have seen is that these technologies and these developments entails the possibility for nations and others to just leapfrog from nowhere to somewhere. When we've gone around to India, Korea, Africa, been very impressed with sort of just these leapfrogging technologies that we see coming out of the countries that we are used to be calling developing, but are as developing as we are. But clearly the inclusiveness of the net was a big issue with us, and we had a special meeting in Africa, as a matter of fact, devoted primarily to that.
Ambassador Reddy. You moved directly from one of the most important institutions in India's national security architecture to a dynamic multi-stakeholder commission. What are the things that the commission got right? What are the things that the commission did not get right? And what's the lesson there for future such global commissions?
I think that first, just maybe to just add to some of Carl's comments and the question you put to Carl. We were 29 commissioners in all from 17 countries and covering 5 continents. So I would say it was reasonably representative. Obviously, we were not the UN. Every country couldn't be represented, nor was there a geographical division between each continent or anything like that. But I think, as Carl said, it was a combination of representing different interest groups that was most interesting, because you had people from the technical communities, you had people from civil society, you had people with government backgrounds, you really had a very diverse group who were coming at it from very different outlooks. Also, as I think there is a digital divide, you know, and within countries as well as between countries. All of these were really the issues we had to look at. I did jot down what I thought some of were the pros and cons of the report, what we could have perhaps got better. Let me say that on the pros, I would say we got the main issues right. We talked about the need for the internet to be open, to be secure, to be trustworthy, and to be inclusive. I think these are very important pillars on which you would have to build a report of this nature. I think what was interesting was that the drafting itself became such a complex exercise because of our diverse backgrounds. People came at it with very, very different outlooks in the beginning. And the way we were able to converge and come up with common ground for all the different people, I think was remarkable. And for me, that in itself was really a great achievement. I think that the convergence was definitely a pro. What I think we could have perhaps got better, and we hope that the commissions to follow will certainly keep that in mind. I think the number of recommendations in the report is very large. And that's inevitable when you have such a large group of people putting their minds together. But maybe we needed to do a sort of a two-step process where we said the main recommendations and the longer list of recommendations. Maybe some of the recommendations needed to be more specific, more concrete, outlining exactly how we were going to achieve those objectives that were outlined there, and certainly maybe reduce the number of recommendations overall. I think we need to talk less about the past and more about the future in all such exercises, because there's a great temptation to analyze the past and even the present. But I would echo what Carl said, that you know, we're on the threshold of an amazing quantum leap in how we use internet technology, because an information technology, electronic technology, because with the Internet of Things, the new high-speed devices, the fact that we're going to have billions of interconnected devices and all of them with different standards of security, different standards of protection, I think these are really going to be the issues we have to concentrate on. We have to have a more futuristic point of view, if you like. I think what we did was necessary because we laid the foundation. I think this was the first comprehensive report of its kind. Maybe it was inevitable that a report of this kind had to look at the background, had to look at the present, and make some predictions for the future. What I'm hoping is that future commissions, future exercises of this kind, and I'm sure there'll be many. I think perhaps later on, if we have a little time, I'd like to talk about what aspects of the report, in my opinion, are most relevant for a country like India and for the developing world.
Thank you, ma'am. Ambassador Rosenthal, if I could bring you in. As the special envoy to not just intergovernmental platforms, but also multi-stakeholder environments like the one we are in, what can governments do to incubate or to facilitate the creation and the working of such commissions?
Let me first say, if you allow me, I'm here in India for not for the first time. And let me reiterate, and actually Carl Bildt already alluded to it, what I said in a earlier sci-fi conference when some of the Indian friends were coining their own country as being an emerging cyber power. I then said that I was a little bit surprised by this modesty, because you are a formidable cyber power right now. And you have really been amidst a lot of developments where you have been very, very active and energetic and ambitious, and sometimes even the front runners. Let me say very, very concretely that when I look to the Netherlands, which is a highly developed country, also a high-tech country, that after all, our software is largely dependent on what you are fabricating here. And when the software is a little bit deficient in some ways, we get back to you to bring it into shape again. And I only need to mention the active role you take in the Global Forum for Cyber Expertise. I can mention the fact which I heard here already, and Carl also alluded to that, that this whole notion of the digital divide should really be rephrased in many ways, including the fact that in many ways non-Western continents by now are really leapfrogging and leaving some of the Western countries behind in many ways. So the whole constellation of the world in the digital era is changing. Now, adding to this, let me take the opportunity to highly commend and congratulate Carl Bild and Lada for what they have done and presented in their report. It is a very important and crucial report. And let me say that the report is indeed intriguing to the very fact that it illustrates the complexity of the cyber domain. It illustrates the way in which a great variety of players are taking part in endeavors. And I would also say, I would highly commend you to do simply your close reading of the three scenarios they have brought to the fore. A scenario, dangerous and broken internet. It's not nothing which is being said there. And I can tell you that in my travels over the world over the last 3 years in promoting the cause of a good and solid internet governance and security in the cyberspace, I have been in the Kremlin and I have been in China, and I have heard too often the spokesman of some government saying that the internet is theirs, which is quite a misleading kind of notion. And we have here the second scenario, which is on unequal gains. And there, of course, we go. If the world is going for a coverage on the mobile phone and in the internet of 90%, we still have a lot to do. I heard here that 90% of India, of the Indian population, is now, in any case, connected. But it leaves 10% behind. And it's in this country, you have somewhat more inhabitants. 10% is here more than in my country of 17 million. So there is a lot to be done. And then, of course, ladies and gentlemen, we have this third scenario, which is about broad and unprecedented progress. And there we go. For the Dutch government, we always work with a triangle when it is about internet and cyberspace. The one corner is about an open and free internet, including an internet which cares for the integrity of the data and also for privacy concerns of the people and the private sector. The second corner is about a secure and safe internet. And the third, not to be forgotten when we look at the downsides of everything going on, the third is about sustained economic growth and social development. And there I link up with the suggestions and recommendations of the Bild Commission. And let me say for that matter that we on our part, on the part of the Dutch government, we usually work with a notion of what we call the three D's. We talk about development, we talk about defense and deterrence, we can't do away with it. It is there as a serious concern. And the third is, of course, diplomacy. And diplomacy is a matter of the long hand. And here, my government is actually aiming at doing something on the diplomatic front for the years to come. And for that matter, we do think about the launching, and we will launch, a global commission for the stability of cyberspace. And that commission, I should tell you, will be a commission with a 3-year term. It is inspired by the recommendations and the composition of the Build Commission. It will be a multi-stakeholders commission. And right now, we already have an endorsement on the part of, for instance, the East-West Institute, the Hague Center for Strategic Studies, Microsoft, your Observer Research Foundation, and not to forget, on the hacking side, the Black Hat DEF CON conferences. And the commission will actually be meant to evaluate and develop concrete proposals for norms and policies to enhance international stability and security and guide responsible state and non-state behavior in the cyberspace. And to be as concrete as possible to you. And we do hope that India will take a very active role in this commission. We do talk here business. We talk about actually looking specifically at the way in which we could protect for the years to come the ability of the core internet functions to provide services to the public. And I repeat, core functions of the internet. And when we talk about that, we do mean the minimal functionality of naming data packets and forwarding them to their destination. We do talk about the way in which we can indeed do something about attack vectors such as routing attacks, massive DDoS attacks, which are on the increase up till this very moment. And we talk about certain other forms of attacks on the public key infrastructure. And here, ladies and gentlemen, we talk also from a well understood national interest on the Dutch side, because we have had our fair share of attacks on our public key infrastructure. The Build Commission, to end up with that, is mentioning it. We had a straightforward attack on our certification authority in 2011, and I can tell you, I was then a member of the cabinet, that some of the members of the cabinet had 2 or 3 totally sleepless nights in how to repair that misery. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Rosenthal, and we appreciate the fact that you made this important announcement about the GCSE in this platform. Carl, if I could come back to you. Between the time, one of the outcomes that the report envisages is the first one that Ambassador Rosenthal mentioned, which is of a dark, deeply insecure, and as you say it, broken internet. Between the time the report, the commission was created, and now when the report has been published, there have been some extraordinary developments which potentially threaten the stability of cyberspace. You alluded to one yourself. And the striking fact is that some of these developments involve the major powers. Do you agree with the assessment, first of all, that there is some challenge to the overall stability of cyberspace? And what can a future commission do in this regard?
There are certainly these challenges. They are grave. What we have seen, and increasing attention has been given to what different state actors do, and sort of the Yahoo breach. I said I don't know the details, but I've just seen the media that they think it's a state actor. And we've seen state actors on the US scene, but elsewhere, doing really rather sort of serious things. That must lead to a discussion on norms for state behavior. And let's see, there's the beginning of that. Then we know that norms in international legal norms, good as they are not always properly observed, but we must start by having them firm. What worries me is also the fact that, and it was alluded to, we're heading to the Internet of Things. Everything is going to be connected to everything. One of our more constructive and creative members of the commission spoke all the time about this being that we're heading into a situation with the weaponization of everything, which is a way of saying that every single device that is there, and everything is a device will have an IP address, that can be turned into part of a weapon system by those who want it. If we don't have the security system and the software systems right. And this will require, I think, a sea change in our approach to cybersecurity. It must be a sea change in the way in which industry behaves. You can't just throw out new software there to the market in order to be competitive without being properly responsible for the holes that might be there, that might turn your toaster or your refrigerator into a weapon in a war that you don't want to be part of. So there's a huge amount of issues. And if these are not dealt with, yes, it might break down.
And what can the what can a future commission do in this space, which is really the remit of governments?
Well, I think there will be a need for, I think the Dutch initiative is a very important one because it takes forward parts of this issue, the stability of the core functions of the internet, the norms for behavior, and a couple of other issues. Then I think the work that is done by the governmental group of experts in the UN is important, and we'll see that's going to be an important discussion next year. What's going to be the follow-on, exactly new such thing, or go into a wider framework. There's clearly a need for a discussion in industry on their responsibility. We started a discussion in the Commission, which we didn't have the time to conclude, and I don't think the intellectual preparedness is there as of yet. Liability issues and the role of the global insurance industry and what's going to happen there. I think that's going to be increasingly important as well as driving more responsible behavior by the private sector actors as well.
Ambassador Reddy, if I could take you up on the point that you mentioned about the importance of the report to India.
You know, apart from making the internet secure, open, trustworthy, I mentioned that we need to make it inclusive and ensure global and universal access to the internet. Internet is for everyone. Fundamentally, the issue is one of equity. And this equity will need governments, private sector, technical community, and civil society. Not only the numbers to be connected, but the quality of the connections that you're going to give to these numbers of people is important. For me, therefore, as an Indian member of the Global Commission, the chapter in the report titled Transforming Societies and Economies Through Access is the most compelling one. To achieve the widest possible practical access is a priority globally and is a core pillar of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, which recognize the need, and I'm quoting here, significantly increase access to information and communications technology and strive to provide universal and affordable access to the internet in the least developed countries by 2020 and to promote women's empowerment. The reasons for the digital divide and the methods by which this divide can be bridged are discussed at length in the report. A telling graph points out that of the 4.4 billion individuals worldwide who are offline, 3.4 billion live in just 20 countries. And 920 million of this 3.4 billion are illiterate. What this means is that only 43% of the world's population is online. But by using leapfrogging, which both of you have mentioned, Carl and Yuri, by using leapfrogging techniques and bypassing PCs and laptops, the mobile smartphones can play a crucial role in this, connecting and transforming societies. Those of you who heard our Indian Minister for IT speak at the inaugural session of SciFi, will recall that the main goal of the Digital India program is to connect more Indians to the internet. And he announced that the government hopes to raise the number of Indian internet users from 400 million, which already puts us as the second largest user of the internet, to 500 million in about a year's time. That's why I feel that this particular aspect is very, very relevant for the Digital India program and for the aims and goals of our government. And I think this will be a big takeaway for us. There are 15 specific recommendations in the chapter I've referred to. I'm not going to go into all the 15. I don't think we have the time for that. But let me just say they're very, very wide-ranging, covering regulatory taxation measures, the need to increase infrastructure, awareness, public access points, the need for different languages and local content, entrepreneurship, to support access for the disabled, to support access for the refugees to the internet, and a real-time data collection of access coverage, because some of the figures we have are not very accurate. But I would say that overall, you know, my own recommendation on this would be that with India's own emphasis on empowerment, using the internet as a tool to increase human development, which also feeds into one of the three D's which you mentioned, Minister, and to distribute social subsidies, using connectivity to improve e-health, e-education, and participation in e-governance overall are of great relevance to us. And I'm pretty sure that not just to 500 million, but we might be able to go to 1 billion, which I think would be the actual figure you need if you have to have as much of the adult population. And not just adults, because I think children are the greatest users of the internet today. And, you know, as I may not have a chance to speak again, may I say what an honor it was to serve on this commission and how much I enjoyed working under Mr. Carl Bildt's leadership. It was an absolutely exciting experience and one that I will always treasure. Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am. And before I go to Ambassador Rosenthal, maybe we can have a couple of questions ready. I think we have roughly 8 minutes to do, so I will just, may I invite you to, before I ask Ambassador Rosenthal, may I invite you to join? Ambassador, one last question from me. What can India and the Netherlands do jointly in this space? The Dutch have steadily taken a highly visible role and profile as the normative power, as one of the major normative powers when it comes to cyber policy making. And in India, there has been this conversation generally on foreign policy about how we should be moving from norm takers to norm makers. And I think there is a generally deep-rooted sense of having an international regime based on the rule of law. What can be done bilaterally?
Well, let me say first that when I heard this phrase of India being a norm taker, there we go again. Well, you are very modest, talking yourself into this position of norm taker, and the smile on your face suggests that there is something more to that than just being a norm taker. And if I look at the development which you have undergone over the last few years, actually, in becoming one of the key promoters of this inclusive and multi-stakeholder approach to the internet, there is something really you can be proud of. And that is, of course, the basis for talking about norms in the cyberspace. And when we then go beyond that, I can only again reiterate my appeal on the Indian government, but also on the Indian private sector, on the very energetic NGO communities here in this country, if not the end users, academia, and the technical community, to join in our efforts to take one small step forward and to be ambitious about opening up the agenda to discussing those norms which need to be addressed. If we don't do it, we will end up with what Carl Bildt was mentioning, that the internet is not just a thing which we can just take for granted. We have to defend it in many ways, and for that matter, to be really on the active mode in the norm setting approach to what we are talking about is very important. And may I take the opportunity to add one point to this? when I hear about the Internet of Things, which is by now, by some people, called the Internet of Everything. Everything is internet. Everything is data connected. Everything is big data. Then we are here exactly with, we see a huge dilemma arising. And I will mention it by a concrete example. When I was in one of the Asian countries, a big country, not being India, by the way, not being China, by the way, the Minister of Science and Technology and the Minister of Public Health told me that they were indeed leapfrogging in the sphere of e-health, bringing it to their more than 100 million inhabitants. I asked them then, how about your basic institutional and legal infrastructure to guarantee that this Internet of Things, if not Internet of Everything, will render the services we want them to render? And then the answer was, we have to think about it. And this makes for the very fact that here we should also join efforts in a energetic mode of capacity building. And for that matter, we have the Global Forum for Cyber Expertise, which can help us out a little bit on this. So, talking norms, talking increase of the capacities of countries to really control and master the challenges involved is of the greatest importance. And there we can join efforts between India, the Netherlands, and other like-minded countries.
Thank you, Ambassador. I was really smiling because you called us modest. Not a lot of people come here.